the second hand unwinds. If you're lost, you can look and you will find me. Time after time, if you fall, I will catch you. I'll be waiting. Time after time, if you fall, I will catch you. I will be waiting. Time after time.
Watching through windows, I'm wondering if you're okay. And you say, go slow, I fall behind. The drum beats out of time. If you're lost, you can look and you will find me. Time after time, if you fall, I will catch you. I'll be waiting. Time after time, if you
welcome to Holston Valley Unitarian Universalist Church. I am the Reverend Tiffany Sapp, the minister of this church, and my pronouns are she and her. We are going to get started with some singing this morning, and the choir's already here, ready to help lead us in this song. So we hope you can sing along in your teal hymnal. Our opening hymn is hymn number 1053. It's in your teal hymnal. So, please rise in body or spirit and join with me in singing hymn number 1053, How Could Anyone?
Thank you.
thank you to our choir, and thank you to all of you for lifting your beautiful voices with us this morning. I just filed a restraining order against my past. It isn't allowed within 100 days of my heart. Regret has been such a stalker. It keeps sending me texts from a burner phone. It tries to slip back in under my long-formed scars. It relentlessly tries to turn my family and my friends against me. And it follows me everywhere I go. It peers at me through my window from the shadow across the street. Yesterday always asks me to give it a few moments so I can explain the error of my yesterways. But I have learned that if I give my old faults a second of my time, it will take a year instead. I finally had enough. So I have blocked all my ancient bygones in order to keep my phone line open so I can finally get a call from Grace that doesn't go straight to voicemail. That's not to say that I'm not sorry to those I have hurt for my past sins. I am so sorry. Sometimes I forget that we are all connected and that I can injure you without knowing it. Sometimes I forget that I am not the only person on this spinning spaceship of nearly 8 billion souls. I mess up all the time, and I likely will again. I promise to try and learn from every single moment that I failed you and me. I promise to do my best to fill the cracks I made between us with gold. I promise to not be so reckless with your heart next time. However, I refuse to turn my guilt into a time capsule that I am forced to open every time I close my eyes. I have to let go of all of my mistakes from yesterday to give room for the miracle of this present moment to dance inside me. So consider this my official goodbye to my past. Thank you for all that you've taught me. I won't ever forget you, but I just won't be in a relationship with you anymore. I'm not who I was yesterday. I am who I am today. And you'll recognize me. I'm in the Mercy Relocation Project. And please join me in a moment of quiet reflection and preparation. Thank you for being with us today as we gather in curiosity and ask ourselves, what do we actually mean by forgiveness? And how can we practice forgiveness in ways that will actually work for us? To do this, we need a space that is less about comfort and more about courage. Our chalice lighting is an invitation to this brave space.
There is no such thing as a safe space. We exist in the real world. We all carry scars and have caused wounds. This space seeks to turn down the volume of the world outside and amplify voices that have to fight to be heard elsewhere. This space will not be perfect. It will not always be what we wish it to be, but it will be our space together, and we will work on it side by side. Good morning.
Morning.
I am Sarah, your service leader here at Holston Valley Unitarian Universalist Church, and my pronouns are she and her. We welcome you to this brave space where you can bring your authentic self. We are a beloved community made of many origins and many beliefs, sexualities, and genders, and we are made stronger by our diversity. Whether you join online or in the chairs around us, we are stronger because of your presence. We grow, we learn, and we love together, just as you are. You are welcome here. Thank you for silencing your cell phones, and thank you for observing the perfume-free zone. We are at low risk now, meaning that masks are optional in the sanctuary, for now. It is still important to remember that some people will still want to be distanced, which will be indicated by the color-coded wristbands. And it is especially important to stay home if you're sick. This is love in action. This Saturday night is our auction, and Charlie, our stewardship trustee, is going to give you an overview of what to expect and how to participate, even if you can't be present on Saturday.
Hi. We're just 6 days away from our service auction, and I'd like to provide some details on what you can expect this week. First, I want to thank all of you for all the item donations. We've been flooded in the past week, so it's dramatically improved since the last time I spoke with you. Our catalog has grown much fuller and more diverse, both from a price perspective as well as the variety of options. I modified the site so you can see the items in order of estimated value. It makes it easier now to see that the vast majority of items are below $50 and some are at fixed prices. Of course, we encourage you to continue your donations, but please have them submitted by this Wednesday. This is the last day we can guarantee your item will be included. There's a certain amount of paperwork to do, so if you slip it in the last moment, it might not make the cut. As the catalog becomes complete toward the end of the week, it's also a time you can start planning your bidding prior to the auction if you'd like to do that. If you have tangible items to bring to the church, please deliver those on Saturday afternoon. We'll be in here setting up. If you cannot make it on Saturday, please contact us at auction@hvuuc.org to make some other arrangements. Some items might be best delivered after the auction, making arrangements with the bid winner if it's something like large or perishable or some other kind of issue. Saturday at 6 p.m. the event begins. Refreshments and childcare will be provided. Initially, there will be a silent auction and time to socialize. The live auction will then run in parallel with an intermission during which final bids for the silent auction can occur. There will be an opportunity at the end to pay for items if you win, but be aware, we will be emailing everyone their bills and receipts, so you have the option to pay later. Any outstanding bills can be addressed in the normal ways you donate to the church, including the offering plate, mail, direct transfer, PayPal. This worked for the online-only auctions the past 2 years, so please don't feel like you have to wait in line at the end, unless you prefer to have it settled that night. In short, please complete donations by Wednesday, deliver appropriate items on Saturday, and we'll see you at 6 p.m. to have some fun. Thank you.
So today is one of these days where our gathering seems to be as much about building our community as it is about the topic that I chose. The auction is one part of our community building work. Technology is another aspect of our community as it stands now. I honestly don't know what any of our churches would have done in the early days of the pandemic if it wasn't for technology. And when we went to dual platform here, reopening the building, how we use technology had to transform again. But it's just as important then, now as it is then, in keeping us connected. There's a lot of people here doing a lot of jobs, and most of them aren't noticed until a piece of technology starts getting difficult. So today, when that is not the case, it's a good day to recognize all the wonderful people who have invested their time and energy into our technology setup. I want to say thank you to Noel, Wendy, and Cindy for their video production work since we've reopened. And thank you to Wendy, Noel, Bob, Rosemary, Brian, Greg, Karis, and Eric for their video camera work. And thank you to Rosemary, Ann, Eric, Bradley, David, Karis, Brent, and Wendy for their work with sound and video technology here in the sanctuary. We are especially thankful that our TV screens appear to be working again. Yeah. David has spent a lot of his time and energy communicating with experts about finding ways to work around the troubles that we were having. I asked him a few weeks ago, are we at 100%? And he laughed at me because technology will never, ever, ever be at 100%. But we're functional. We'll take it. So as this particular issue has affected how the religious services team could use technology for our services in the last few months, and because it took so much work to set it right, the Religious Services Committee has asked me to present David with a small gift, which he doesn't know about, in recognition of how he has gone above and beyond to resolve these technology challenges for us. David, do you mind coming up here for a second? You don't have to say anything, but we just want to give you a gift.
Thank you so much.
We are grateful for David and for each of you who have stepped up week after week to make our technology needs work for us. In celebration of having the whole system working again, we want to take a little moment to express our thanks. Sound.
My name is Ann Johnson, and I'm the president of the Board of Trustees. We have one more community moment to celebrate today as several new members are joining our congregation. We welcome our newest members from your seats. They are Betty Jackson, Mike Jackson, Eric Perner, Brent Chaffin, Courtney Johnson, Katie Quillen, Ben DeWitt. And we also welcome Cynthia Anderson, who could not be here today, but will sign the book. Today, you enter a community of people who believe that we never stop growing and that we learn best from each other. We do not have all of the answers, but here you find people who live joyfully and creatively in the gray area. Here you will find comrades and compatriots in your search for justice and peace. Here you will find connections to the interdependent web of life. We welcome you as members of this religious society. We rejoice when you walk with us in our quest for community, justice, and love. Your presence encourages and strengthens our communal life. We accept our responsibility to include you in this free and open church. We invite you to join us in our pursuit of justice, to share our spiritual journey, to challenge us, and to reflect on a life lived fully. We ask you to walk with us in freedom, trusting your instincts and reason, sharing your hopes and fears, your joys and your sorrows. As Michelle announces your name, please stand or raise your hand so that we can know who you are.
Betty Jackson. Betty Jackson was born in Churchill, Tennessee, and has lived in this area most of her life. Early in her lifetime hospital career, Betty was a nurse technician and a unit secretary. After graduating from ETSU, Betty became a registered nurse. She has worked at several area hospitals and has been a floor nurse, charge nurse, and retired as a nurse educator. Betty and her husband, Mike, have been married for 51 years. Mike Jackson. Mike Jackson is a native of Washington, D.C., but grew up in the Kingsport area. A graduate of East Tennessee State University, Mike worked in commercial radio at several area stations before returning to ETSU and earning his master's in history. After a second career teaching history at Walter State Community College, he is now retired. Eric Perner. Eric Perner, whose pronouns are he, him, was born in New Milford, Connecticut. He first became a UU at Ginger Hill UUC in Pennsylvania in 2013. Eric moved to Tennessee in 2018 and began coming to HVUUC last April. He considers himself to be a star person, angelic, other kin, and Eric's interests include science fiction, nature, cats, UFOs, ghosts, ESP, comedy, and football. Brent Chaffin. Brent has been coming to this church with their family for many years, off and on. They have moved closer to this area again and decided to take church more seriously. Brent is the parent of a wonderful child. The most spiritual moments of their life are writing and performing music. They are a firm believer in the power of community and social cooperation. Cynthia Anderson. Cynthia moved 30 times by the time she was 50. She and her husband, Eric, retired from Air Force Space Command in 1999 and moved to Roan Mountain. She enjoys music, humor, watching hummingbirds, blowing bubbles, massages, watercolors, and the color turquoise. Watching how her four grandchildren are being supported gives her hope for the future. Katie Quillen. Katie Quillen has lived in Johnson City since childhood. She enjoys making art, singing, and spending time in nature. Together with her husband, Ben, they are raising two curious children, Stevie and Lila. Katie has especially enjoyed the chance to get to know our youth by teaching stellar sex ed. Ben DeWitt. Ben DeWitt grew up in Johnson City. He loves board games and tabletop role-playing games and taking an introspective perspective on life. Together with his wife, Katie, they are raising two lovable children, Stevie and Lila. Courtney Johnson. Courtney is a 25-year-old autistic adult with multiple disabilities. She is a graduate of the Tennessee's Partners in Policymaking program, which is involved with various disability advocacy projects. Courtney will be graduating from ETSU in December. She has a well-loved cat named Layla.
I welcome you.
I welcome you to our congregation. I charge you to hold our religious society close to your hearts and work to keep it vibrant and meaningful to you. For this church can only be what you make it. I charge the congregation to accept our new members with joy and embrace them as you do now one another, for they are truly one with us. I charge us all to treat each other with compassion and understanding, for only with love will we survive. New members, you have a part to read in the bulletin in response.
On behalf of the Board of Trustees of the Holston Valley Unitarian Universalist Church, I welcome you into membership and full participation in this community. We hope to earn your trust and come to know you in true religious community.
We welcome you to our midst in the spirit of freedom. May your days among us be long and full, and may we prove worthy of your trust as we travel together. Yeah.
What a joyful day. The adding of many to our community as official voting members, the working screen, and Saturday night's auction are joys that we hold together. What other joys and sorrows do we have to hold as a community today? If you'd like to share a joy or a sorrow in person, you can use a candle card. We've run out of the printed ones. We'll get that fixed next week, but we do have some cards in the back if you want to share. Or if you have a joy or a concern that you want to share from a distance, please email minister@hvuuc.org. Today, I want to take a moment to recognize all of our veterans and wish to share with you a Veterans Day prayer by Audette Fulbright Folsom. Today, we bow our heads in recognition of the great service and sacrifice some have been asked to make. Living through the horror that is war, facing death or physical harm as a specter looming around any corner, we want to say thank you, and we know it will never be enough. Help us to embrace those we have sent forth in our names into danger. Give us the strength to serve them as they have served us. May they never hunger. May they never thirst. May there always be meaningful work for their hands. May they receive healing care in abundance. And may we, the grateful heirs of a nation built on the idea of liberty, be faithful to pursuing that dream in our lives and in our actions. Help us to be vigilant and never complacent. Let each one of us take personally this charge. May it be so, and may it be so. Amen. If you wish to light your own candle, go around and form a line by the window, and Frida will assist you. If you wish for us to light a candle for you, please raise your hand until I acknowledge you, and I will light a candle for you at the end. And we light our first candle for you who are not in the building, but are forever in our hearts. Unspoken in our hearts and minds.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rachel. I'm a guest to your church here today, and my pronouns are she, her. I will be introducing the song that we're going to be performing for you today. So we're going to be playing All Apologies by Nirvana. So Kurt Cobain, who is the author of this song, was really known for their sarcastic lyrics. And in this song today, there's one lyric, Everyone is Gay, which was really their ironic stab at homophobia. In addition to this lyric, there are a lot of other lyrics that people, that actions really, that people will either grant or seek forgiveness for. So with that being said, we're gonna let the song speak for itself, and we're gonna play it for you today.
Bye. best of songs. Everything is my fault. I'll take all the blame. Aqua seafoam shame. Sunburn, freezer burn. Choking on the ashes of our enemies. In the sun, in the sun, I feel as one. In the sun, in the sun. Buried, 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 buried. Yeah, 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 yeah. All in all is all we are. 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 All in all is all we are.
Thank you. That was amazing. Consider this. Many people have trouble with forgiveness because they have been taught that it is a singular act to be completed in one sitting. That is not so. Forgiveness has many layers, many seasons. In our culture, there is a notion that forgiveness is a 100% proposition. All or nothing. It is also taught that forgiveness means to overlook, to act as though a thing has not occurred. This is not true either. A woman or man who can work up a good 95% forgiveness of someone or something tragic and damaging almost qualifies for beatification, if not sainthood. If she is 75% forgiving and 25%, I don't know if I can ever forgive fully, and I don't even know if I want to. That is more the norm. But 60% forgiveness accompanied by 40%, I don't know, and I'm not sure, and I'm still working on it, is definitely fine. A level of 50% or less forgiveness qualifies as a work in progress status. Less than 10%, you've either just begun or you're not really trying. But in any case, once you've reached a bit more than halfway, the rest will come in time, usually in small increments. The important part of forgiveness is to begin and to continue.
Thank you to Sarah and to everyone who's contributed today's service. I don't have it prepared in here, but as I was listening to the band say, choking on the ashes of my enemy, that metaphor, that image really says a lot about what we can do to ourselves in these processes of pain and resentment, and what forgiveness can offer us to a chance to clear our throats, so to speak. So this week, I was visiting with one of our long-term members, and we got to talking about last Sunday's remembering service. Specifically, we were talking about different people's views on what comes next, if anything, after we die. And she said something very interesting about her own position. She said, "I don't know what I believe, but I definitely know what I don't believe."
And it occurred to me that as I unpacked the baggage around the word forgiveness, that I really need to clarify what I don't believe about forgiveness. I want to toss harmful beliefs about forgiveness out of the forgiveness baggage so that I can make room for the more useful understandings. So, here's what I absolutely do not believe about forgiveness. First, I don't believe that it's some sort of supernatural exchange where I can't be forgiven by God unless I forgive everyone else. I feel like these sorts of statements are manipulative and that it's bad theology for anyone who claims to believe in a loving God that's actually paying attention to our lives to require us to fully forgive before we can be forgiven. Second, I don't believe that forgiveness is really ever completed. Like the reading Sarah shared with us, most of our healing is in progress, and that doesn't mean we're failing at it. It just means that we need to give ourselves the time and the space to process the hurts that we've experienced. And that trust is only rebuilt when someone wants to rebuild it. And even then, it will take time. And third, I don't believe that forgiving is always the right move. Sometimes we have to hold a boundary to protect ourselves. East Tennessee Unitarian Universalist minister Jake Morrill wrote about this third aspect in his introduction to a book that he wrote called The Christian Art of Forgiveness. He says, if forgiveness traps you in a destructive cycle, if there's massive power imbalance or abuse, then you don't need to learn how to forgive your abuser. You need an exit plan. Reverend Morrill also talks about how you cannot force forgiveness when someone isn't ready for it. He tells about how his home church, the Tennessee Valley Unitarian Universalist Church in Knoxville, had an active shooter incident in 2008 where two people in the church were killed and several more were injured. The media flocked to the site, gathered around Reverend Chris Bice, the minister there, looking for some dramatic declaration of forgiveness for the shooter, something that has really become expected when spiritual communities endure a tragedy. And he did not do it. It made the press and all those TV viewers uncomfortable for Reverend Bice to not follow the expected narrative. Reverend Morrill says that as he watched the scene unfold on his television, he realized no one will make a movie of the week out of this. It wasn't comfortable, but I saw how his actions mattered to the people that I love. It certainly gave me permission to feel angry, scared, and sad without racing to declare a forgiveness that I didn't feel. Forgiveness might be helpful for the people of Tennessee Valley eventually, but their minister gave them space to have their complex emotions that they needed to have before they could really authentically consider forgiving. Forgiving too soon is a form of spiritual bypassing where we sacrifice our authentic human reality in order to deny or avoid the pain that comes with it. So what is forgiveness then, and why does it matter? Jake Morrill describes forgiveness as releasing those things that are weighing you down so that you can walk through life more lightly, unencumbered by the weight of resentment and hate if you were the one wronged, or guilt and self-recrimination if you were the one who did the wrong. He says that forgiveness is a practice, an inner quality that you develop over time, like a muscle that goes stronger the more you exercise, doing that striving to forgive. Letting go and being free is something that gets better and gets easier the more you work at it. Carrying the burdens of harm done can be so draining. So in spite of the ways that this beautiful practice of forgiveness has been misused, it is a gift. It is a good thing. We might even owe it to ourselves and our community to reclaim forgiveness and define what it means to us, and to set boundaries around the practices of forgiveness to keep it being a good thing for us. The Netflix limited series From Scratch gives us insight into the painful struggle of repairing relationship when real harm has occurred. The story I'm about to tell you is a minor spoiler, but it's not the main plot of the story, so I hope you'll forgive me for sharing it. I do highly recommend this show, but you need to bring like multiple boxes of tissues with you if you're gonna watch it. So in the story, a father and a son had been estranged for a very long time. The son left his family home and his family farm in Sicily to become a chef. His father resented his leaving so deeply to the point that when his son gets married, the father does not attend the wedding and forbids the rest of the family from attending the wedding as well. And he's the man of the house in a very traditional Sicilian village, so of course he has the power to forbid the rest of the family from seeing their estranged son. So later, they come to an uneasy reconciliation, but it's nowhere close to actual forgiveness. To use the reading's way of phrasing it, maybe 15% forgiveness. So they at least got back into the same room together. The reunion was motivated by the son falling very ill, but the pain and the tension over the son leaving and the father shunning the wedding had never been addressed. As they gather around the family table for a meal, another family member announces an engagement, and the father is ecstatic, waxing poetic about how wonderful weddings are. Yeah, ouch. So this is finally enough for all of the son's accumulated resentment to boil over. The son says that the father should be ashamed to celebrate a stranger's wedding without coming to his son's. The father counters, says the son should be ashamed for leaving his home, his family, and his land. And there's no easy solutions in this argument. Dad still feels abandoned. The son still feels unfairly punished. And like his dad would never let him be himself. In the peak of the dialogue, the argument, the letting out of all the resentment, the dad says, "I don't understand you." And the son says, "I know, but can you accept me?" And the dad pauses, and you can see in his face how he is struggling with this. He's been holding on to this sense of betrayal for so long, unable to see himself as anything but the victim in this story. But
he's starting to hear that his son is saying that he left because he could not be free to be himself at home. So the father's hurt and his traditional values are at war with the love of his son and the longing for a real relationship with him. All of this passes over his face in an instant. As the father struggles, the son finds a little space, a little strength to take a risk, to be vulnerable and try for reconciliation. He says, "Look, Papa, my disease can come back at any time. The truth is I'm tired. I'm tired, Papa. I can't fight this disease and you. You have to choose. Are we two angry men or are we father and son?" In his book, Jake Morrell writes, "What kinds of actions are forgivable?" That's a trick question, he says. You don't forgive an action or a behavior, you forgive a person. Forgiveness occurs in the context of relationship. Who are we gonna be? Two angry men or father and son? It's so true that sometimes relationships really are broken beyond repair, and that sometimes the most loving thing you can do is to love yourself enough to cut a continuously harmful person out of your life. That is sad, and it is true. But it is equally true that there are times when you are deeply hurt and you want to try again because there is something in the relationship worth mending. And that something only you can decide. No one can tell you where and when to do the hard work of forgiveness. So let's begin to end our time here by contemplating this. Is there a relationship in your life that can benefit from a dose or two of forgiveness? Not a surfacey, there's nothing to forgive here sort of situation, but recognition that real harm has occurred and that you want to see if you can salvage this relationship. Are you the one who did the hurting? I know that's a hard thing to confront. Usually when we're thinking about forgiveness, we're thinking about who we need to forgive. It's harder to think about where we might need forgiveness. We'd rather contemplate the times we were blameless, but in our glorious, imperfect humanity, I believe that each of us here are probably in need of forgiveness for something. Is there a relationship that can be restored by you taking personal responsibility for your actions and doing your work to change behaviors? What if the person isn't ready to forgive you? That's okay. They are not obligated to forgive you. In those cases, striving to forgive yourself, which often comes as we work to change our behavior, is a healing way to go. You get to the point that when you've done your work, it's time to let go of the misery and the self-recrimination, even if you can't heal the relationship. The continued burden can get in the way of the good you can do now. Can you invite yourself to do better in the future instead of beating yourself up about the past? Or, if you were the one who was harmed and you feel like you're ready to work on forgiving, ask yourself, what do you need for this relationship to be healed? What boundaries can you ask for? What will help you release the burden of anger, fear, and grief? Because the practice of forgiveness is all about relationship, the journey to get there is going to be as unique as the people that are in relationship with each other. I can't offer you a simple three-step process to mend all your relationships. Today, it is my hope that we find what we need and that we release what we can, and that we find the happiness and relief that is waiting for us on the other side of forgiveness. May it be so.
As we prepare to extinguish the chalice, take a moment to consider. Is there something you've been holding on to that you're ready to let go of? Something you want to release for your own benefit? Hold it one last moment in this silence. And then let it go. In this brave space, we release what we can and entrust the wisdom of minds, hearts, and bodies to guide us through the rest. Thank you for being with us today. We hope that you are giving some thought to how you want to be a part of this community that works together. We hope you can stay for coffee hour after the service. We have a cake. It's to celebrate our new members. So, have something sweet and introduce yourself to someone you don't know today. Our congregation will have a tree on display during the Johnson City Candyland event in Founders Park and King Commons. The name of our tree is the Giving Tree, and it is named this because we will have donated items in Ziploc bags for people to take if they so need. To ensure that our tree looks in the holiday spirit, we are asking for donations of items for giveaway and also weatherproof outdoor tree decorations. Additionally, we need volunteers to help decorate the tree on Friday, November 25th at 1 p.m. The tree comes with lights, but we will need a 10 to 12 foot ladder for decorating the upper portion of the tree. This looks like a really tall tree. We need the following items for donation: hats, gloves, mittens, socks, scarves, shampoo, conditioner, bar soap, and dental hygiene supplies like toothbrushes, toothpaste, and floss. The donation bin is right back over that way by the bookshelf. If you're a visitor and you can leave your contact information at that back table, where you can also get more information about what's going on in our community. Or you can visit hvuuc.org.
Thank you for being with us today. I hope you'll be able to join with us next week, where longtime friend of the congregation, Dion, will be sharing with us how raising a puppy taught her about Unitarian Universalist values. And we're so happy to have both of you with us today. This is breaking news. It was literally handed to me like 2 minutes before the service started. Francie Hunt has been going on a 600-mile walk through the state of Tennessee to show her support for Planned Parenthood. She started all the way in the West, and she's been making her way toward the little northeast corner of the state that we call home. So I just found out that she will be at Fishman's Gallery in downtown Johnson City at 5 p.m. today. Like, I'm very sorry we didn't have better notice, but we've actually been trying to get this information. So I'm very glad we have it. If you want to show support for her, it's at 5 p.m. at Fishman's Gallery in downtown Johnson City. That is on Commerce Street behind Trek Bicycle. And I was told that you all will know where Trek Bicycle is. So, okay. But, you know, Google Maps is awesome too.
I also want to make you aware that there's another opportunity to make a stance on reproductive justice this week. There will be a rally at the Bristol, Virginia City Council this Tuesday, November 15th at 4:30 p.m. as they are discussing new zoning regulations which would close the clinic in Bristol. Tuesday, November 15th, 4:30, Bristol, Virginia City Council, and people are being asked to wear pink and bring signs. I'm so grateful that we are a community that cares about these things. Here's our benediction from the poet Rudy Francisco. Gather your mistakes. Rinse them with honesty and self-reflection, and let dry until you can see every choice and the regret becomes brittle. Cover the entire surface with forgiveness. Remind yourself that you are human and that this too is a gift. Our closing hymn for the month of November is hymn number 354, We Laugh, We Cry. The great and challenging work of being in community, of learning to love each other, of trying to forgive each other is so worth doing, and the affirmations in this hymn really speak to me about that. This week, we're only singing verses 1 and 4. We're only singing verses 1 and 4. This is also when we pass the offering plate. If you have a pledge payment, please mark it as such. And thank you so much for your generosity. Please rise in body or spirit for our closing hymn, number 354, We Laugh, We Cry, first and fourth verse.